Welcome in, everybody, to the best in true crime talk radio. This is True Crime Tuesday. I'm Tim Dennis. Interesting program for you today in that we don't cover a lot of corporate spies or white-collar crime, but we're going to do so today. Read an interesting book over the weekend, and there's a couple of interesting occupations that cross themselves in this new book, and I want to meet with the author of this new book who's led a very interesting life. If I could say to you that you could combine the financial side of life with the Hollywood entertainment side of life and somehow make a living at both and not burn the candle at both ends and drive yourself absolutely nuts, and yet still make a very good living at it, meet a lot of interesting people, and manage not to throw yourself in the clink for a very long amount of time, you'd be pretty interested at that, wouldn't you? Our guest today is author Robert Kerbeck, and we have a lot of catching up to do here with this book. The book is called Ruse, Lying the American Dream from Hollywood to Wall Street. And let's bring in Robert now to talk to him a little bit about his life and just how exactly he didn't go insane during all these days of rusing and trying to keep an acting career going at the same time. Welcome to the program, Robert. We greatly appreciate you being here on True Crime Tuesday.
Well, thank you, Tim. I'm honored to be the rare corporate spy on your program.
I wouldn't say corporate spy. We've had some white-collar criminals on our program, but I can't say in what you do, and we'll describe what it is you do or have done in just a little bit here. But what you do, or I shouldn't say what you do, what you have done in the past is quite unique. Let's back up a little bit, though, and I want to get to your upbringing, because I find it fascinating that people who live on the East Coast, I think, have a different mentality when it comes to white-collar jobs, when it comes to hustle, put it that way. And a lot of what you had to do in both your careers, plural, had to do with hustle. And not just the Wall Street side or the financial side of what you were doing, but also with the Hollywood side. Me being a Midwest boy, I think we tend to be humble. And sometimes humble is not a good thing. Humble can get in. And I think you know what I mean here. Humble, You dealt with a lot of people on the other end of the phone that were humble and wanting to help. And I think you found that to be, correct me if I'm wrong, a weakness, is it not?
You know, I'm sorry to say, Tim, but yes, you're right. The kinder you were, the more of a target you were for a corporate spy, right? What I was looking for was people that were nice, people that were friendly, people that wanted to help, people that wanted to be a good corporate teammate. And what I would do is, by impersonating somebody else within a major corporation, I would utilize that kindness. You know, I have a chapter in the book, Preying on the Kindness of Strangers. And I would get people to then release information about the company that they should never release. So the Midwest thing, I mean, in my rusing, there were certain cities that I would target because I knew the people there were more user friendly, right? Mm-hmm. People in Dallas, Texas were very nice. You know, people in the Midwest were very nice. People in New York, not so much, right? And so I would oftentimes, when targeting corporations to extract information, I would look at where their offices were, and I would try to utilize those offices to my advantage.
With that being said, when you're growing up, when you're coming up as a kid into a teenager, you're growing up in the Philadelphia area, correct?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Pretty hard area to grow up in. And your father and uncle own a car dealership, correct?
Correct. Yep. Yeah. In one of the roughest sections of North Philadelphia.
So you're really being groomed for a hard life. I mean, car sales is not easy, not an easy job by any means.
No, and I think one thing that people don't know about when you're a car dealer, you know, it's your business. You know, my great-grandfather came over from Armenia and sold horse carriages before cars were invented. And then he started a dealership. You know, the placard on the front of the building, which we still own, said since 1899. So there was this, you know, generational thing of taking over the business, and it was hard work. You know, I mean, you know, my father, when I was young, you know, forget about 5 days a week. It was always 6 days a week. And it was from the crack of dawn until late at night. If somebody came in the showroom door at 8:30 or 9 o'clock at night and they wanted to buy a car, I mean, you were there till midnight, you know, working on that deal and doing the paperwork, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's, you know, it's 6 days a week. It's a lot of hours, and it's your business. So, you know, it succeeds or fails on your hard work, or, and the word you use, on your hustle.
Tell me, Robert, what's the toughest thing about selling a car? I know people may think, what's this got to do with true crime? But I'm gonna connect this to what it is you do later here in the book.
Tim, that's the best question. Honestly, the best question I've been asked in all the interviews I've done. Because my father taught me that from day one, is you have to satisfy the customer's objections. You have to identify what are the objections to buying a car right now, today. What are the objections? Do they like the car? Okay, they really like the car. Okay, so that's not an objection. Is there a financial thing? Well, how can we help them with that? Maybe we can get them a loan, you know, maybe we can make the price lower. Maybe we can see if they have a trade-in, right? So that's what we're trying to do, is satisfy objections. And that is something that I learned from my father, which of course completely translated to the rusing, right? Mm-hmm. Because I had to satisfy people's objections. Well, wait a second, who are you? Wait a second, why should I be giving you this information mm-hmm. over the telephone? You know, mm-hmm. So it was the same. It was the same skill set, satisfying people's objections.
That's exactly why I wanted to line those up. So you're in the family business, or you're starting to come into the family business. It was your father's wish that you get into the family business as you're going into college, correct?
Yeah, definitely. And then when I graduated college, I went and worked there for a period of time, about a year and a half, because I had gotten bitten by the acting bug in college and did a lot of really cool plays. And I wanted to try to be an actor. I wanted to go to New York to be an actor, but I just didn't have the courage, because I didn't know anybody in the business. You know, I didn't know anybody was an actor. I didn't know anyone in New York. I knew it was a difficult business. I knew it was hard to make a living. And so instead I went to work for my father, and I was doing some plays locally at night. And at one point I got hired, funny story, I got hired to be the lead in a music video, when being in a music video was a really big deal. Mm-hmm. And I was the lead in the music video. It was a band called the Hooters, who mm-hmm. had, you know, some fair level of success. In 1985, they played Live Aid. And this was the lead single for their second album. The single was called Johnny B. I played Johnny B. You can put it on YouTube right now. And I think it's a pretty good video, actually. Mm-hmm. And the video was directed by someone you've never heard of, a young man named David Fincher, who went on to direct Seven and The Social Network and Fight Club and a million other really great films. And David was young, I was young, and he hired me for this. And the story that I heard later on from the producers of the video was that Madonna saw that video and she liked it so much that she hired David Fincher. And then he went on to direct a number of her iconic videos, which then propelled him into a film career. So I'd like to think I had a tiny bit to do with David Fincher's very, very successful movie career.
I'd say you made him, Robert. That's how I put it. I'd just say, you remember that David Fincher guy? I made him. That's how I'd put it. Just be humble about it.
Wait a second. What happened to the humble? Where did the humble go there?
That is humble. I made him. Without Johnny B, there'd be no David Fincher. That's how I'd put
it. Okay, I like this Midwestern humble thing. I think I can go. I think I can work with that.
Well, that's my East Coast coming up. what now? So And by the way, we know a little something about it. I'm a little older than I sound and look, so I do remember the Hooters. So I do remember the video. And I remember Live Aid, and I remember all that stuff. I'm early 50s, so I remember it.
Stuff. We're right about the same age.
There you go. So from there, you know, you've got the acting bug, and you're starting to do little bits and pieces and little acting jobs. But it's really when you start to. Now, let me get this straight. I'm trying to remember the name of the college. Was it Drexel?
I went to Drexel for 1 year, and then I moved across the street to the University of Pennsylvania.
That's right. After a professor recommended that you come over there because of the work you were doing. And then from there, you start to make waves and doing plays and getting involved in your acting. And you go to New York. And you start to get more involved in acting. And is it at this point that you come across a very famous institution?
Famous institution. Are you referring to the Actor Studio?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So, for your listeners who might not know the Actor Studio, that the Actor Studio is probably the most famous, acting laboratory in America. And some of the people, actors that were developed in the Actor Studio are some of our most famous film actors of all time. Al Pacino, Marlon Brando, Robert De Niro, you know, Jane Fonda, Ellen Burstyn, Chris Walken, Dennis Hopper, you know. So it's a very famous place. They only let in a handful of people each year. And I was lucky to become a lifetime member of the Actor Studio. And then when I got into the Actor Studio, I started interacting with, again, some of the most famous people in cinema history. And at one point I did a play at the Actor Studio. And after the play, I'm in the, you know, backstage in the dressing room, and Paul Newman comes back to congratulate me. And his eyes were so blue, so piercing blue, I could not look him in the face. I was too much. It was really too much. I mean, his eyes were like, you just couldn't look at him, mm-hmm. you know, in addition to he was, you know, Paul Newman, right? Mm-hmm. But he couldn't have been nicer. And then he and his wife, Joanne Woodward, invited me up to their, you know, penthouse apartment on the Upper East Side. I thought I was going there for sort of a literary salon event where I was going to be in the audience. And then when I got up there, they pulled a little bait and switch, and they asked me to read a movie script, playing the part of this race car driver in the movie script. And Paul Newman was, this is 11 a.m. on a Sunday, and Paul Newman had a six pack of beer at his feet. I liked his style. And he was sitting in a chaise lounge while everybody else was reading with five beers at his feet, one in his hand. And he was very upset because he felt he should be reading this part in the movie of the race car driver. And Joanne Woodward said, "You're too old." And he didn't really like that very much, but basically I was playing the Paul Newman part in this, in this reading. Mm-hmm. So experiences like that were very exhilarating. They made me feel like, my moment of stardom was right around the corner. And of course, almost all actors that come to New York, they need a survival job, you know, while they're establishing their career, you know, and I had left the car business because it really wasn't for me. I didn't really kind of like the trickery that was involved with some of the sales. Cause at the end of the day, you're trying to sell the car for more money rather than less money. And so there's, some subterfuge that's going on there. And then I go to New York and I stumble into this job as a corporate spy. Now, who stumbles into a job as a corporate spy? But that's what I did. And I kind of didn't know what the job was at first. And it was a little mysterious. Nobody would really tell me what we were doing. And then, of course, as time went on and I started to get trained, I began to realize that the spying was far more dishonest than car sales.
Now, let's walk through that a little bit here, Robert, as you came to understand it. Now, you... obviously you didn't want to do the typical bartender, server type jobs, not quite fitting what you needed to do in order to do auditions. So you run across, I believe it was an ad in Backstage magazine, correct?
Well, the woman whose firm this was, this mm-hmm. secretive firm, she put ads in backstage all the time. She kept them running because the job was so difficult to do that actors all wanted to do the job, but it was a very rare individual that had the unique skill set or confluence of skills that could make you a corporate spy, because you had to kind of have the actor's gift of gab, but you also had a little bit of a business sense, and not many actors kind of had that second part. But I heard of the job because my college roommate's brother got the job first. Okay. And he was actually the first man that the woman had hired. In the book, she's Leona, and Leona only hired women because she didn't think men could do this job.
Okay.
And my buddy Pax was the first one she hired, and then he got me the job. And it's funny, I did an event recently with former CIA spy Valerie Plame, mm-hmm. and she was interviewing me, and the issue of that issue came up of that only women did this job, only women had been hired to do this job, and I at the time found it surprising, and maybe even today I still find it a little surprising. Valerie didn't find it surprising at all. She said women are better spies than men, and she started talking, and this is a CIA agent, right? And yeah. she started talking about women are able to reflect and deflect better than men. Like, they're able to kind of be a little bit more chameleon-like, and not get defensive and not get aggressive. And they can kind of, you know, and she used that word, reflect and deflect. I thought it was fascinating. And I think she's right, you know, because we were the only two men that Leona ever hired that worked out.
Is that an empathy or an ego thing?
Probably a little bit of both. I think that's a good point. Probably a little bit of both.
I find it interesting that Valerie would say that too, because, you know, there are men that have a deeper sense of empathy and also have the ability to suppress ego to be able to do that, to be able to reflect and do it exactly what you're talking about. And I guess I would disagree with her on that, you know, that there's, because, you know, there has to come a point, you know, when you're talking about reflecting and deflecting and being a chameleon of sorts, there are examples, and especially in this book, where you and Pax need to come up with a different strategy. And we'll talk about that here a little bit later as well. When you need to change your business almost, or your business model, in order to continue. And you almost have to become a little more forceful in the way that you go about things. Not saying that women can't be more forceful. That's not what I'm saying here. But it almost takes an authoritarian presence to do this. And I think you know the examples that I'm talking about. If you don't, I can cite them a bit later.
No, for sure. I understand exactly what you're saying. And indeed, we switched, you know, we call them ploys, right? We would come up with ploys that were designed to get information, and we would use different ploys for different situations. Sometimes we would use accents, right? Mm-hmm. You know, so many of these firms are global now, right? And they have offices in every country around the world. So you could be in the Frankfurt office, you could be in the Dublin office, you could be, you know, in any office. And you could utilize that because, you know, we're still on the same team. Mm-hmm. I may be in the Dublin office, but we're still on the same team, and I've got an emergency and I need your help. And boy, I'm in trouble, and you're a good teammate, so please help me out. Right.
Right.
But also what we would do, and this is what you're getting at, is that I think Pax and I recognize that the women were being more successful than we were. And that was when we realized they were rusing fellow assistants, fellow receptionists, because, you know, we're talking now kind of 90s, early aughts, and the workplace, especially the Wall Street workplace, was still more male than female, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And certainly at the executive level, it was more male than female. And then, unfortunately, now today that's changing and it's much more balanced. So the women were really effective with the junior level people, the assistants, the receptionists, because they could bond with them. And what Pax and I realized is that we needed to go to the executives. And what we found stunning and really shocking was that these major executives, these individuals that were making millions of dollars, were far easier marks than the assistants and the receptionists and the junior people. it's almost as if the junior people and the assistants and receptionists who were told and trained not to release this information listened to their training, followed their training. But the executives, oh, well, we're big shots. We're important. We're making a lot of money. And so we would be executives from other offices. I'd be, you know, Gerhard calling for the office in Frankfurt. I'm the managing director running the group here. And they would bond in a very kind of, you know, male, masculine, bro world. And like, how can I help you? What do you need? And they would go out of their way to give us information that they never, ever should have given us.
Now, some people may be following along with what we're talking about and saying, well, who exactly are you calling? Give us an idea of the clientele that would come across to Leona that she would send you and Pax and others on to try and come up with these lists, and who exactly were on these lists.
So Leona's clients were mainly Wall Street firms. And when I started, I was mainly rusing Wall Street firms, and that's how I got my reputation as sort of the, you know, arguably the best corporate spy in the financial institutions industry. Mm-hmm. But then later I branched out, and when I had my own firm, we were researching technology companies. We were researching automobile manufacturers. We were researching healthcare. We were researching any companies, any industries on a global basis. I researched Russia, Japan, China, South America, Canada, Europe, everywhere. And I think that, you know, what I learned from that is that the skill set that I had and the skill set that we developed on Wall Street, we could take it to any industry and we could find out whatever information our corporate clients wanted. And every corporate intelligence project is sort of bespoke. So, you know, every client wants to know different things. Generally, it all started with the organization chart, the organizational chart. So, who's in the area that you're looking for? Who's running the group? What are the names of the teams? Who are the team members? And then we would take it further and go, okay, well, who, we would basically rank the individuals based on who are the best people, you know, and we would get the internal metrics from the firm. So if it was a sales team, we'd get the order of the sales revenue. If it was a trading desk, we'd get the number of trades or the amount of the trades the traders were handling. If these were wealth managers, we would get the size of their book of business. And that information was incredibly valuable. Remember, you know, I like to say I was LinkedIn before LinkedIn was invented, and we know how big LinkedIn is. Everybody listening, how many of you, the listeners right now, are on LinkedIn? Mm-hmm. Most of them,
yep.
Right?
Yep.
Right. So the ability before LinkedIn, you know, all of this information was non-public. It was private. You couldn't get it. And so if a one firm wanted to improve their rankings in a certain area, they wanted to increase their revenue in a certain, how did they do that? Well, they needed to poach, steal top talent from a competitor. How did they get that information on the top talent? They came to me, and I would basically help them find, you know, who the proverbial rock stars were. And so that was how all of the research started. You know, we would get these organizational charts, and then we would start adding stuff on top of that: rankings, bank of book, you know, book of business. And then oftentimes in doing that, we would even begin to determine what the firm was doing, what their strategies were. Were they adding people? Were they firing people? Were they opening offices? Did they have acquisition plans? You know, what were their strategies? What was their pricing? All of this different non-public nitty-gritty information that nobody knew. You know, we forget because now we live in a world where we can kind of Google anything we want to know, but not that long ago, you could not do that, you know? I'd like to think that the crash of 2008 was a kind of a big change, because after the crash, really the amount of information moving from private to public, it was like a, you know, an accelerator, right?
Right.
LinkedIn before the crash, in its infancy, right after the crash, everybody was going on to LinkedIn.
So I would ask you this question then, Robert. What's the difference pre-2008? What's the difference between headhunting and speculation and what you were doing? What's the difference between legal and illegal?
That's a great question. I mean, I think that the kind of corporate spying that I was doing still exists today. You know, the rusing, the impersonating real people, pretending you're someone else to extract this information. We all know the Russians spy on the Chinese. Mm-hmm. We all know the Chinese spy on us. But most people don't know that major American corporations and international corporations are hiring people to do this spying every day of the week today. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't do that anymore. I haven't done it for a while. I got out of the rusing business, which is, of course, why I can write a book about it, because I wouldn't be a very good spy if I wrote a book about spying when I was still spying.
Right.
So I don't do it anymore, but it still goes on. And even with LinkedIn, there is still a tremendous amount of information that is private, that corporations want to know about. And it's really valuable, you know, so I'll give an example. So Steve Jobs, you know, and we're going to go back some years, but Steve Jobs would not allow his designers of products to be listed in the Apple directory.
Okay.
They were like secret people, right? Hmm. Imagine how valuable it would be if I were able to determine who the design team for the original iPad was in the early days of that product. How valuable would that, right? If I were able to find that out and then give that information to whatever competitor was paying me, right? And it's the same thing in any industry. And that's what corporations are looking for, is they're looking for that information that can take them from being ninth in their space to second in their space or number one in their space. And a lot of time that information that does that is obtained through rusing.
I think at this point we'll take our break. When we come back, I want to ask you, Robert, what kind of dangers come with rusing and corporate spying? We know, obviously, when you're spying with the government, there's other governmental agencies that obviously can come at you with weapons. They can come at you, threaten your life. They can do other things. We kind of want to know the danger levels of what's going on with rusing. When we come back, we'll talk the danger level of what it is that Robert's doing. Plus, we'll talk a little bit about how his acting career advanced and what exactly happened with his acting career. That'll come up next. The book is Ruse, Lying the American Dream from Hollywood to Wall Street, a memoir by Robert Kerbeck. And it's available right now. If you go to the description of the show, there's a link in the description to take you to get that book. You can do that right now. Click on that link and order a copy of the book. It is a very fascinating book. Like I said, I got through it through the weekend and I had an enjoyable time reading the book. So I encourage you to go out and get that book as well. Lots of great stories in there and lots of names you'll recognize in there as well. And lots of great anecdotes and stories. So I encourage you to go get that book right now. When we come back, we'll talk about the dangers of rusing when we are talking to Robert Kerbeck right here on the best in True Crime Talk Radio. This is True Crime Tuesday. Welcome back to the best in True Crime podcasting. This is True Crime Tuesday. I'm Tim Dennis. We're talking today about rusing, about corporate spying. And our guest is author Robert Kerbeck. The book is Ruse, Lying the American Dream from Hollywood to Wall Street. Robert Kerbeck is the author and the guest. Robert, before the break, we were talking about the actual dangers of rusing. We know about what happens with government spies and the danger that they put in their hands when it comes to what it is they're doing. Explain to me the black and white of spying and the gray area of what it is that you do and exactly what can happen. What are the potential penalties and the danger level of rusing? What exactly can happen to you if you're caught?
Well, that's a good question. And one that I, you know, wrestled with for many years. When we first started the job again, you know, it was just to pay the bills as an actor. I remember exactly what we got paid. We got paid $8 an hour, which, you know, I guess today would be kind of like your $15, $16 an hour job. When we first started out, we were just doing kind of pretty generic sort of ploys. We'd say we were a student and we were working on a paper, and could you please give us this information? And of course, most times people would laugh in our face and hang up, because they're just, you know, they're busy and they're executives, and it, you know, it didn't make a lot of sense. And so over time, you know, we realized that to get the information, you had to have a ploy where you had some connection to the company. So we created these ploys where we weren't employees of the firm, but we were with a firm that had a relationship with the other firm. And so that worked a lot better. You know, we started to get a little bit more information. But even that was problematic. And we just weren't getting the kind of results that, when you make these calls and it's a difficult job to do and you're getting kind of rejected time after time after time, you sort of a natural competitiveness kicks in that you're like, I want to get this information. I need to get this information. Of course, I needed the job. You know, I wasn't rich. I didn't have any money. So we began to realize that the only way to really get this information on any sort of consistent basis was to be as if we were employees of the firm. So we were basically called that going internal, right? We were going to represent ourselves as internal individuals with the firm. Mm-hmm. And for a while, we would say we were internal individuals with the firm, but we would use made up names. And eventually people began to, you know, as corporations had their internal intranet, they could look you up. So if you said, oh, I'm Bob Jones in the tax department, they would look up Bob Jones and they would go, well, there's no Bob Jones in the tax department, and you wouldn't get information. And that was the kind of the moment where, like, we kind of started going from, you know, light gray to very, very dark gray, you know, because now we realized that the only way to get the information, to get quality information on a consistent basis, was to be an actual individual within the company. And that was when we realized, you know, if you're going to impersonate someone that exists, you know, that is, that is something you could go to jail for. You know, that is definitely going to be a crime. You're violating a number of laws related to wire fraud. We rationalized that, well, you know, we're doing, you know, we're actors. We're doing this not to get rich. We're doing this to, support our art. And at the end of the day, the intelligence that we're obtaining, for the most part, is being used to get people better jobs, right? Yeah. Okay, it's capitalism, you know, and that, and I'm not saying that's right. I'm just saying that's the rationalization that we put through our heads. But as we were doing this rationalization, at one point, my buddy Pax, who got me the job, we talked every day. You know, we helped each other with ploys. Called me up one day, and basically the authorities had come to his home, and he wasn't there. But they, he lived in Brooklyn, and they had some interaction with the landlord that they were looking for him, and that they had been looking for him for some time. So he obviously called me, panicked isn't even the right word, you know, petrified, because, you know, as far as he knew and I knew, if he had been there, they would have arrested him, you know? So that was pretty frightening. We didn't really know what the story was. And, eventually what we found out was the authorities thought that we were, at the time, the individual who was the world's most famous hacker. The New York Times had been writing all these articles about him. They called him the Darth Vader of hacking. He had been on the run. He had been on the lam from every organization, you know, that you could think of, the FBI, the U.S. Marshals, the Secret Service. And we kind of knew about this guy, this Kevin Mitnick. You know, we couldn't believe that people thought we were Kevin Mitnick. You know, we were just actors with the gift of gab making $8 an hour, you know.
Yeah.
And long story short, right after this experience happened with Pax, Kevin Mitnick was arrested, mm-hmm. As a domestic terrorist. He was sent to jail, solitary confinement, 23 hours a day. And as you can imagine, that was a pretty frightening moment for us, because what Kevin was doing was basically the same kind of social engineering rusing that we were doing. So that was the moment where, you know, we realized that we had really severely misjudged the danger of this job. And so we really, you know, it was a frightening moment. And moving forward, we never, ever again misjudged, you know, what we were doing. We now knew the risks. You know, there's a line in The Sopranos where Carmelo is seeing a therapist and she's trying to justify, you know, what she does and her involvement and what she knows and what she doesn't know. And the therapist kind of shoots her straight and basically says, you're just as guilty. You're complicit.
Yep.
And he says, now you can never say you were never told. And this was kind of that moment for us. We're like, okay, now I know that I could go to jail for a long time. And, that was, you know, we used the word humbling earlier. That was a humbling moment. Like, wow, you know. So, yeah, the danger was quite real.
Humbling, but at the same time, when you look at how the delivery systems were used and the effect, and bear with me, Robert, if you will here. Kevin used a computer, forced his way into a company, broke up their sovereignty, and took information, okay? Hence the domestic terrorism, okay? Yet you called the company. True, you might have misrepresented. You're gonna laugh when I give you the spin on this deal. You called the company. You might have misrepresented yourself, but at the same time, they gave you the information when you called. You didn't break anybody's sovereignty. The information was given when asked for. So in a way, if I'm arguing as your lawyer in court, I'm presenting to the judge that in no way did you ever break in and break the sovereignty of that company. You were asking for information. It was given. It was an exchange of information. And an exchange and a relationship was especially if it was done more than once. And I believe it's Zoe in the book that you develop a relationship with, one of the moles over time.
Right. Well, Tim, I'm definitely going to hire you as my attorney if I get in trouble because I like your thinking.
but you know, it's, so I think that when you talk about the differences between Kevin and you and Pax, I think there is a definite, if I'm a lawyer sitting down and I have to represent you or Kevin, I'm picking you over Kevin because with Kevin, there's no argument. You know, there's a difference between a scalpel and a shotgun. You know, a scalpel is a fine device.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's funny. We talk about that. I talk in the book, I say, we considered ourselves to be like brain surgeons. Now, of course, mm-hmm. I'm far from a brain surgeon and I'm not comparing myself to a brain surgeon really. But the idea is that we were going in with a scalpel to gingerly extract the information that we needed without raising alarms,
yep.
without raising hackles, without, getting people suspicious. And so it was really important because look, we were calling these firms again and again and again, right? You know,
right.
These major technology companies, these major Wall Street firms. And so if we were, you know, kind of, you know, making it so obvious that we were, you know, rusing them and trying to get intelligence, you know, they would all be up in arms all the time. So the idea is you got in very quietly, very kindly, very nicely. You had a wonderful conversation with somebody, mm-hmm. you know, they're your new best friend and you hang up the phone and they have a smile on their face. That
right.
was a perfect ruse call.
Right.
They had no idea, you know, they just helped out a fellow employee and they're feeling good about themselves and they go on with their day. And you know, and that's what most that, you know, we got so good. That's what most of our calls were like. Right.
Right. And you're going to laugh when I tell you this, too. As a lawyer, you could argue you were closer to the kid calling the neighbor and asking, is your refrigerator running rather than assaulting a company with a computer and trying to take them down from the outside.
Now, the only thing that we do have to point out about Kevin Mitnick versus us is Kevin Mitnick was not doing this for financial gain.
Well,
Kevin
true.
Mitnick was, yeah. right? He was making yeah. no money from his hacking was just about for a lot of hackers, it's about the thrill, right?
Yes.
The thrill of being able to say they did it. We were getting paid. So, you know, there is something there where, okay, well, you know, what we're doing, we're actually being compensated for. So I hope you're right. Fortunately, you know, one of the reasons that I didn't write the book in 2010 was I needed to take some time for statute of limitations to expire for any potential crimes I've committed. And I did have someone at one of the very organizations that theoretically would come after me read this book and make one or two kind of changes just to make it clear that the rusing was in the distant past. And he said, you know, it's long enough ago, you're fine. But of course, you know, I asked him that question about, you know, if back in the day, you know, we had been, you know, kind of hauled in, you know, he said, you know, it really depends on the prosecutor, you know, because if a prosecutor wants to make a case, you know, in this situation, you know, of this rusing, you know, there was definitely a case to be made for, you know, locking us up. And I'm glad that we were, you know, lucky enough, fortunate enough, and you know, maybe skilled enough that we went in and kept a low enough profile that we never, I never went to jail for this job. I only went to jail in the TV show Sisters when I killed George Clooney.
Thank God you did that. as nice of a guy as he is. I mean, thank God somebody killed him. You know, I do have to ask you this, Robert. There's a, and you know, without giving away too much of the book, there is a point, and I bring up the East Coast bravado versus, you know, the sheepishness of us here in the Midwest, in that it takes a certain personality to branch out and to keep going. And rusing to me doesn't seem like a business that has a blueprint. You know, it's not a business that you can sit down and like with the car dealership, you know, your dad could sit down and say, well, son, here's how you run a dealership, and can hand you a blueprint or a manual and say, you know, this is everything that you need to know to run a dealership. Throughout your life, you start to figure out you go from Leona to different organizations. You have to move your way up the ladder due to financial reasons. You can't work for $8 an hour the rest of your life. In fact, there's a few times you go from one organization back to Leona and then to another organization again, isn't there?
Yeah. Because, you know, again, back in the day, I mean, Leona was making a lot of money. In the beginning, I didn't realize how much money, how lucrative this business was. Again, you know, I was just a young actor, young kid, young guy. And then over time, I began to realize that she was making millions of dollars. But, you know, in a normal situation, you know, I would go and work for another firm, but I didn't know of any other corporate spy firms. You couldn't look them up in the, you know, back then the yellow pages or, you know, or some business directory. So there was no way really to find out about another firm. So I was stuck, you know, and that was hard because I knew the information as we got better and better with the ploys and we developed more sophisticated ploys and we're getting amazing, you know, insane information on these corporations. I knew that it was worth a lot of money, but I there was no way I could, you know, and then I just happened to luck into hearing about another firm through one of Leona's other employees who was working for both of the firms. One of the women was kind of double timing Leona. Mm-hmm. And I remember at the time how scandalous that was. But then I was doing the same thing because the other firm was paying us twice as much money.
And at that point, you really did need the money. You were barely getting by. And it goes from there where you're slowly making your way up the ladder until finally somebody says to you, you know what, maybe you should be doing this for yourself, and offers you a partnership. Correct?
I think what happened was, so you know, I'm in New York and I'm doing all this really great theater and I'm working with James Gandolfini and Calista Flockhart. You know, I'm in the lead in the play opposite them. And I got a rave review in the New Yorker and my picture on the cover of the New York Times art section. And, you know, it's all good. And I have an agent and my agent says, move to Los Angeles. I moved to Los Angeles and I'm still doing the ruse on the side to pay the bills. Mm-hmm. And then I get to LA and I kill George Clooney on Sisters so that he can go to the show we never heard of called ER.
Yeah, never heard of it.
And I And I work with O.J. Simpson the week before he becomes America's most famous double murderer. And I, you know, do Star Trek and Melrose Place and Chicago Hope and all these great shows. And I'm like, I'm on my way, you know, and the ruse is always like, it's in the background, but I'm just about to give it up. I'm almost making it enough as an actor that I don't need it anymore. And every time that I feel like I'm about to just give the ruse up, all of a sudden acting gets a little dry again, right? So I'm like, ooh, well, I'm glad I didn't give the ruse up because I need that money to pay the rent. And then I get another acting job. Oh, okay, I'm back. And, you know, and acting, of course, like, you know, any artistic field, is really difficult. And not only is it difficult to do the art and get your art seen and noticed, but to get paid for it, you know, good luck, right? It's a very, very challenging thing. You know, we see these people at the very top and they're 1/10 of 1/10 of 1/10 of 1/10 of 1%, right? You know, it's just so hard. So, you know, I didn't give up the rusing. You know, I'm acting, and I booked a number of pilots, none of the pilots went. I did four different pilots, none of them went. And all of a sudden, my acting career really kind of did dry up. And that was the moment where I really kind of went deeper into the ruse, because right around then, it was the early aughts, and it was the buildup to the crash of 2008. And remember, the crash came as a result of the, you know, irrational exuberance, and, you know, money and free money and loans and credit and the stock market. And there was such a demand for, that was kind of like the golden era of corporate spying, the aughts, right? Because there was some technology, but there was, most of the information was still private. So the only way firms could get it was to hire, you know, a corporate spy. And so I was being offered finally a lot of money to do the spy, right? And and that was the moment where I really kind of, to use the Star Wars, crossed over to the dark side, you know, where I really was like, okay, you know what, I'm gonna make this money. You know, I'm going to make this money. I haven't made it as an actor. My acting career has kind of died. You know, I went to this great school, Penn, and I had a lot of friends that were working on Wall Street, and they were making $10 million a year, $15 million. And I'm like, what are you doing that is worth $15 million a year? You know? Yeah. And so I had a little bit of a resentment about that I was like, you know what, I'm going to get my small piece of that pie, you know? And, you know, again, this is not me saying it's right. You know, what I did was dishonest. You know, I'm not proud of it. It is a hell of a story. But that's what I did, you know, and I did that until the crash. And then, of course, when the crash came, all commerce pretty much everywhere stopped, you know. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I had to take a job. I had to go to work. And I got my first job, and I hope my only job in corporate America. And I went to work for a global executive search firm, a recruiting firm, a headhunting firm. Yep. And what I found, much to my shock and amazement, was that the lying done in the corporate world face to face was seemingly worse than what I was doing on the phone. And that, you know, and I think that's a fun part of the book for readers, because, you know, here they've seen me rusing, and if they're if they get mad at me for some of the rusing, don't worry, I get a pretty good comeuppance in the book. I definitely get paid back in full, right? So, you know, hang in there, readers. You know, I get it in the end. Trust me.
There's a good payoff there, Robert. I have to ask you this question, because, you know, I've got to get your perception, your feeling as to, you know, you're not only, for lack of a better term, a headhunter when you're rusing, when you're collecting this information, especially for financial wizards, for lack of a better term, on Wall Street, when you're getting these names for other people to hire. But when you run into a situation like 2008, when the market falls apart, when you find out that it was, I don't want to say all for naught, but when you find out that one lie on top of another lie on top of another lie created this balloon that eventually burst, and you had helped stack the cards, okay? Mm. So you would help put one guy in a position and another guy in a position, another gal in a position and another gal in a position. And all these people had created this giant house of cards that eventually fell down and blew away. Is there in your mind a bigger sense of responsibility, or do you just say, I had nothing to do with it, all I did was provide the ammunition?
First of all, that's a great question. And I've been thinking about that a lot because I've been watching the show on Netflix, Inventing Anna, right?
Yep.
It's a fascinating story, and the performance by the lead actress, Julia Garner, is just out of this world, right? Yes. She's just incredible.
Yep.
But it's also interesting to me. I'm like, wow, you know, she went to jail for a couple of years, you know, and I was thinking about her going to jail in the context of the 2008 crash where nobody went to jail.
Right.
Nobody went to jail.
Yep.
And I think that's what's amazing to me, is that there were all of these shenanigans. So you can talk about my shenanigans, which I'm being pretty clear with, but I have to say most of the other people have never come clean on their shenanigans. Right.
Right.
So the Wall Street firms, you know, were lying about the worthiness of the loans that they were selling. The rating agencies were lying about the true worth of these loans. The homeowners were lying to get the loans. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, the mortgage companies were accepting the loans that they knew had the homeowners were lying on. Right. Everybody was lying. Everybody was rusing everybody, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And as a result of that giant ruse, the country almost crashed, right? The country did crash.
It did.
That's why it's called the Great Recession, right?
Right.
And so you know, when I was watching that show, Inventing Anna, I'm like, you know, this is one young woman, she. And not to excuse her, but it seemed like she paid a far heavier price for a lot less than, all of these different, and forget about individuals, major corporations.
Yeah.
Major corporations. And I joke in the book that if anybody ever wants the roster of everybody responsible for the 2008 crash, I'm the only one on the planet that has it.
That ran through my mind as I was reading the book. As I'm reading the book, I thought to myself, you know, if anybody knows every single player that was involved in the 2008 crash, it would be you.
Yeah.
And as I thought about what questions I wanted to ask you today, that was one of the questions I wanted to ask you today is, do you feel like you were the guy who lined up the ammunition for that crash, or do you, and does it weigh heavily on you? Because in that, and follow me if you will here, Robert, and I won't dwell on this for very long, but as you pointed out, there were, in the days that followed, if you remember right, you had presidents, senators, representatives, anybody in government calling for reform. There was huge shouts of reform, and there needed to be more than just internal restructuring done. There needed to be more than just legislation. There was hints of, you know, there needed to be prosecution. You know, you would hear the words prosecution, but nothing ever came of it. You know, the words prosecution came out, but then you would hear in the same breath, but who do you prosecute? You know,
right. Well, I think the issue was that the list was so incredibly long that everybody just threw up their hands, because you would have literally been prosecuting everyone,
mm-hmm.
every Wall Street bank,
yep.
every mortgage company, every individual at the mortgage company that was, you know, putting together these bogus loan applications. You'd have to prosecute the homeowners that signed their name on these bogus applications.
Right.
You'd have to prosecute all the people at the rating agencies that, you know, I mean, you would have, hundreds of people going to jail. I mean, and theoretically, you could have thousands, tens of thousands, right? Because it was so pervasive, right? This ruse, right, was so pervasive. And you know, yeah, you can certainly argue that, you know, I was a small cog in that very dirty machine. And, you know, look, I think, you know, I wrote the book mainly because I wanted to come clean. You know, I've written an honest book about lying. That's how I describe it. It's an honest book about lying. I think I don't pull any punches with anyone, and I certainly don't pull any punches with myself. I have a scene in there with my son where my son at one point hears me rusing on the phone, and it's like a you know, one of those, you know, life-changing moments where I realized here I've been rationalizing this for so long, and there was no more rationalizing. It was dishonest, you know, and I didn't want to do it anymore. Mm-hmm. And it took a child, my child, to make me realize that, you know? You know, I think that, I hope that answers your question about, the giant ruse of 2008, that a lot of people were responsible, and it's a shame that people weren't prosecuted for that.
I have just one more question when it deals with that, and then we'll get off that subject. And that's this: when you look back at it, and I think you almost have to draw the parallel. Do you almost look at it like when you look at the rankings of who you would put together to recommend to a client? If, like, let's say you've got a financial firm that's looking to hire someone who's the hottest, you know, hottest whatever out there, and they're looking to cherry pick from different financial firms. When you look back at it now, is it almost like looking back at the Baseball Hall of Fame and trying to induct somebody from the steroid era? Do you realize that that all these numbers might have been inflated by artificial means? Sit back and think that, you know what, maybe these people weren't the best, or do you ever, I mean, cause you know, hindsight's 2020, and right. When you think about it now, do you think, were we all just kind of playing a make-believe game?
Well, I mean, that's a really astute comment, because, there was one trader, Morgan Stanley team, led by a man. There were eight people on this team. And in 2006, he and the team did a trade that made Morgan Stanley $1 billion.
Whoa. Right?
So everybody wanted to know who were the members of that eight-person team. And you might think to yourself, well, how hard could that be to find out? And I'm here to tell you, impossible, impossible. I mean, forget about those people being listed anywhere. No, no, no. And, you know, when you tried to penetrate, to get that information, to talk to somebody, nobody was telling anybody anything, right? But everybody wanted to know who those people were, because they knew if they could get one or two people or three people from that team to come to their firm, they had a good chance of replicating and making that $1 billion trade. Well, I'm here to tell you, those individuals on that trade that made Morgan Stanley $1 billion, a few years later, they did another trade that lost Morgan Stanley, I think it was $6 billion.
Oh.
So your point about, don't put them in the Hall of Fame too soon.
Yeah. 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 That thought hit me too, is, were we playing in the steroid era there before 2008, and, you know, how exactly would you rate them today type of deal?
Right. Right. That's right.
Yeah. Interesting stuff. So you alluded to the fact that, you know, your son heard you rusing, and that really was what kind of wrapped it up for you, that it kind of changed that something inside of you. Let me ask you this. Have you ever gotten to that point now, post the book, post your son hearing you, where you've thought to yourself, much like, and I know this is going to come across as an evil question, and I apologize ahead of time, Robert, where maybe things are a little tough, or maybe you just get into the idea of the thrill of doing it. Do you ever think to yourself, you know, maybe I could pull off one or two jobs that could pay decent?
Well, it's a great question. It's not an evil question at all, because I am emailed constantly from major corporations asking me to please spy. Even though they know that I don't do the spying anymore, even though they know I have a book coming out about the spying, or the book just released, so it's out now. Mm-hmm. And it really is amazing to me that they don't seem to care. They don't seem to care. Now, as I mentioned earlier, I think I'd be pretty foolish to be on your podcast talking about being a corporate spy and going back and doing spying. So I promise you that's not happening.
Right.
But I could, you know, and I could create a fake account this and a fake name that, and, you know, blah, 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 blah. If I really wanted to, sure, I could do that, or I could try to do that. I think it would be ludicrous. First of all, because, you know, I don't want to do that in terms of the ethical issues.
Yep.
And then of course there are also the crime and punishment issues. What is it, fool me once, shame on me, fool me, shame on you, fool me twice, shame on you. Right. Mm-hmm. And I'm probably getting that wrong, cause I always get these metaphors wrong. So feel free to correct me, but the point being that I got away with rusing in the past. Mm-hmm. I don't think I would be so lucky a second time. But it is amazing, you know, if your listeners are out there and they're looking for a career as a corporate spy, there's plenty of opportunity.
How has it changed now? I got to think that it's just not picking up the telephone and doing it anymore, is it?
I think the hardest thing is getting people to pick up the phone now. Because, you know, people don't talk on the phone, they text, they email. So you've got to get somebody to pick up the phone, and then you've got to convince them somehow that you need them to give you this information over the phone. So, yeah, I think it has gotten much, much harder, much, much harder. But, you know, like I said, I think there are people out there. I know there are people out there doing it. I know there's a lot of money in it. One of the characters in the book, when he found out I was writing this, and he's still spying, he was panicked that his career was going to be ended. and he was panicked that my book was going to shut down corporate spying, and there was going to be this, you know, congressional resolution that says no more, you know. And of course I thought the whole idea was ridiculous. I thought it was actually kind of funny that he would think that my book would have any impact on corporate spying.
Let me ask you this, Robert, in closing, do you feel it'll have quite the opposite effect, that this will just kind of be a little ripple in the water? Somebody may notice it, that they'll say, you know, corporate spying, it may become kind of a topic of the week and in business circles and news circles, and then it'll get a little bit of a bright spotlight and then move on? Or do you feel like this will turn a little attention to it for a little while?
I don't know the answer to that question. I think that's, you know, that's part of the reason why I wrote the book is, you know, there was the moral reckoning for me personally. Mm-hmm. And then there was also, what can this do? You know, Frank Abagnale, who wrote Catch Me If You Can, you know, and he did all these scams when he was a young man, and he was really amazing and gave me a wonderful blurb for my book after he read it. And I did not know him. I've never met him, but he read the book and just really was taken by it. And after he did his scamming career, he turned a new leaf and joined the FBI and helping them prevent check fraud and a number of other types of frauds. And he speaks all over the world now. And so, you know, he works with a speaker agency, and he recommended me to them. And now we've been talking about me putting together some type of program where I would go out and speak to conferences and organizations and colleges and whatnot about, you know, how to prevent this perhaps at your firm, or how not to fall victim to this type of scamming. Because as you know, scamming and phishing happens every day. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, a lot of times, you know, I never was targeting individuals personally, like personal information, your credit cards or your finance, you know, that was never me, but there are people that are doing that all the time. And maybe I could be of service to people in terms of, you know, offering ways to not fall victim to that, the elderly to not fall victim of that. And so that's something that I'm exploring and I'm excited about.
I'm curious, because the way you said it, it almost makes me think this, but when you say, hey, kids, you know, there's plenty of rusing jobs out there. Do you look at rusing as maybe being a victimless crime, especially if you're committing it against bigger business? Does it?
Well, those are your words, you know. And again, you, like you were saying before, you know, I wasn't taking it from them; they were giving it, which I thought was kind of fun.
well, I mean, they kind of are, you know. If you work hard enough, they're giving it to you.
Yeah, I mean, look, yeah, I mean, you can make an argument, you know, I guess, and I guess that's the argument you're making, is that people have been trained not to do this, and so if they're doing it, they're violating what they've been told to do. So that's on that. That's on them, right? And forgive me, I'm going to drop the humble. I am very humble at all, but sure. You know, I'm really good at the ruse. You know, I was really good at the ruse. And so, you know, there are a lot of people that, you know, I'll have conversations with and they say, oh, well, I would never fall for it. And I, you know, it's everything I can do to keep my mouth shut because, you know, 99.9% of the time, when I got an assignment, I got the information. 99.9% of the time. I mean, it was almost never that I couldn't get what my clients wanted. There's almost always someone at a firm that'll tell me what I want. I don't know victimless because, you know, there are people that I took advantage of in terms of getting that information. And yeah, you could say, okay, well, they were working at the corporation and they were certainly getting a hell of a lot more than $8 an hour. And they'd been trained not to give that information. And so, you know, but, you know, and that's why I think I took my rusing more to the executives, because I felt more comfortable because I'm like, these guys, and they were mainly men because I was utilizing the male to male thing.
Yep.
They were making a lot of money, you know? And so, so that was a way that I didn't feel so bad about it because, you know, I wasn't taking advantage of the, you know, the kid out of college, you know? But now, you know, I don't quite think it's a victimless crime. I mean, I appreciate you kind of letting me off the hook a little bit there, but I don't think that's true.
Okay. I mean, I'm just curious. I not saying one way or the other. I'm just asking if you believe it's a victimless crime. The reason I ask is because, again, in the book, you state that really in retrospect, it's giving it. Well, when you first started out, it was getting the names of financial people, getting them into the hands of somebody who is looking to hire them. Really, it's taking people who are making a whole crap load of money and getting them to people to make them a whole lot more money than what they were making before, really. And you're just getting a small, very small piece of that pie. It was almost like a Robin Hood type deal.
right. Yeah. Except I wasn't robbing from the rich and giving to the poor. I was robbing from the rich and giving to the richer.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. It was a reverse Robin Hood. Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know, when you justify it that way, it's kind of like, wow, it kind of is a victimless crime. But then, you know, you say to yourself, well, you know, are you, because if you look at it this way, and again, I'm not justifying crime here. I want to make sure that my audience knows this, but again, we compare it to Kevin Mitnick, was it? And in his hacking.
Yeah, Kevin Mitnick.
Mitnick, I'm sorry. So he takes a computer, he breaks through the sovereignty of a company and their firewall and their computer systems. Well, you forcefully entered into a company to obtain information, whatever that information may be. Whereas you call on a telephone, just like any other customer would call, you've made conversation, whether that person has given up information to you or not, it's their decision. It doesn't matter what methods you've used to try to pry that information. It's whether they've given that information to you or not. It's their decision. So to me, it's two different schools of thought. You know, I could say, you know, I could call, oh, I don't know. Let's say I could call Bank of America tomorrow and say, you know, I'm Frosty the Snowman and I need to know your CEO. And and all of his officers tomorrow, and
right.
You know,
and their salaries
and their salaries,
you know, their yeah. private cell phone numbers and, you know,
that's
all
right.
of that stuff.
Right? Yeah. And, right. and, if they say, wow, Frosty, how did you learn how to talk? Well, I could have a half hour discussion with them. And if they're still enamored with me and want to give me that information, that's great. Then we've just had a wonderful conversation. I got what I wanted. They got what they wanted. If they say, I don't believe you're real, and then hang up on me, then that's what happens. So, right. you know, I get where you're coming from in this book. I'm not saying I'd co-sign on it, but I'm just saying I get where you're coming from in the book. Speaking of, the book is Ruse, Lying the American Dream, From Hollywood to Wall Street. Robert Kerbeck is our guest and the author of that book. I encourage you folks to click on the link in the description of this program and go get yourself a copy. It is quite intriguing, not just from the Rusing part of this and the white collar crime part of this, but really your journey in the actor studio, the stories you have about James Lipton in themselves. I'm a James Lipton fan, so I was enamored with the couple of stories there about James Lipton. But then you know, just the human interest stories in here as well, Robert. I was quite enamored with and enjoyed myself. So I want to encourage our audience to go out and get a copy of this book. But Robert, I want to thank you very much for joining us today on True Crime Tuesday.
Oh, it was a true pleasure. I really enjoyed this.
Well, thank
you. And stay close to your phone. If I need representation, you're my first call.
I will definitely be here, and I'll only charge you $4,000 or $5,000 an hour. I mean, no, I'm kidding. You'll probably get me for $1.50. I work very cheap. It's you know, in the world of podcasting, we don't make that much anyway. So $1.50 will probably be about the going rate. So there you go, my friend. All right, it's a time where if you're listening to the free version of the show, we must bid you adieu. But if you don't want to leave us right now, you don't necessarily have to. What you can do is you can go to Stitcher.com, click on the subscribe button under Stitcher Premium. That will get you to listen to Dumb Crime, Stupid Criminals. That'll get you to listen to the ad-free version of Darkness Radio. And that'll get you to listen to hundreds of podcasts ad-free and expand your audio horizons more than you could possibly ever imagine. And the best thing is you can do it for just $5 a month. Do it right now. Go to Stitcher.com, click on that premium button, subscribe to Stitcher Premium for just $5 a month. You'll get Dumb Crime, Stupid Criminals as far as True Crime Tuesday. You'll get an ad-free Darkness Radio. And of course, you'll get hundreds of podcasts ad-free and expand those audio horizons. Go ahead and do it today. Be sure to tune in tomorrow for Darkness Radio, as we have Supernatural News that's coming up tomorrow on the best in paranormal talk radio, Darkness Radio. For Beer City Bruiser, I'm Tim Dennis. Join us again next week for True Crime Tuesday.